I'm Bobette Braxton. Currently, I'm acting president with the John G. Black Historical Center in Galpolis, Ohio. We don't know exactly who he was. There's a bunch of allegations. They said he came up from Cincinnati and he was a runaway slave. Then we heard he may have been the son of President William Henry Harrison, but we don't have proof of that. And I do have people who are descendants of John G. that says they cannot find proof for him being Harrison's son. But we don't really know who he was. We just know when he got to Galpolis, Ohio, he was wealthy. The 1850 census shows him having $5,000, and that was big dollars in 1850. Right, that was according to the 1850 census. His first show up in town was 1818, and that was because the church history for at that time, the Bethel AME Church, shows that it was organized by he and his wife Barbara and six other people. But how he got to know about the AME movement, we do not know, because the AME movement was actually just started in 1816 in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Everybody knows the founder of the AME movement, though. Well, we knew that he was a wealthy man. We knew he owned properties in both Galpolis City and Gallia County. We knew he was a carpenter, famous for his archways that he put in houses. We knew that he built several houses that are still standing in Galpolis, Ohio, including the current church, but he built a two-story brick. He was a bricklayer. Two-story brick home on 1st and Pine in Galpolis. There's a two-story brick that we know he built on 3rd and Pine. And we have a funeral home next door to the church called Wall Hollywood. And we know that he built that funeral home, which is now encased in a gray facade. But when they had that done, they took a picture of the original house and gave it to John G. So we do have that house still that we can show to people. We also know that there was a house that Speedway was able to obtain when they expanded their gas station. And we know that house, which was torn down, was also built by John G. And then we had a special bricklayer came in, Laura Snow from the Aerial Theater. She had a bricklayer specialist come, and he also went through Galpolis and pointed out one other house that had the way that John G. laid his bricks, and that was a house on 3rd and Spruce Street on the corner of that house. So that's about five houses that we know he actually built besides the church. Well, we know he had many, many pieces of property on Pine Street, and he built some of those wood houses. They were not bricks, so we don't know. But another impact besides an actual AME church, which would have been past 200 years old, because it was founded in 1818, so in 2018 it would have been 200 years old. And he also donated, it was 4 acres across the street from our current Pine Street Cemetery. He donated 4 acres, and we got it historically marked as the Pine Street Colored Cemetery. It was purchased only to put the black citizens in who did not have burial places attached to their churches or their own private cemeteries. They were buried in the Pine Street Colored Cemetery. Currently, you probably couldn't find an acre of that land, so where the 4 acres are, we don't know, and where the 333 people buried in it, we do not know. Well, it would be on Pine Street, at the end of Pine Street. Pine Street is 1st, 2nd, 3rd, and 4th, and before you get to 5th, you're going out of town, and there's the Pine Street Cemetery on the right-hand side, and the Pine Street Color Cemetery is on the left-hand side. That's where it's located. And in those days, remember, they wouldn't put up tombstones, so we could have put houses over top of them. The train used to come right through that particular part of town. The highway goes through that particular part of town, and they could have picked up the land that way for their right-of-way. Well, after many, many years, hundreds of years of service, in 1998, there were only 4 members left of that AME church. And by that time, it had been renamed For John G. And instead of Bethel AME, the first church would have been Bethel, named for Mother Bethel Church in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, which is currently standing. It's the largest landowner in Philadelphia for black property. But they renamed it when the Union soldiers had used the first church as a hospital. And when they left it in 1865, it was completely torn down and no one could save that church. So he dedicated the land directly across the street, and the current church that we have was renamed for him because he was the benefactor of it. So that's why it's called John G. AME Chapel. In 1998, there's only four members. They could no longer maintain it. They were Dorothy Casey and Robert Casey, Edna Casey, and Alice Buford. And they solicited the Congress, the Methodist Congress, to give them the church, and they did. So they got together, called people together, say, who's interested in preserving the history of the church? And several people came together and met. We formed an executive board, renamed the church the John G. Black Historical Center, and made sure it was not a museum. It is a place you can come in, listen to the history, touch our artifacts. We give tours and presentations, but that is how we actually got started, and we've been in existence since June of 1998. So next year, if the Lord wills, we'll be there for 20 years. But that is how we got started as the center. The big thing is learning Black history locally. Ours is not Black history nationwide. Ours is Black history in southeastern Ohio, so we're very selective on the things that we're researching and presenting on tours. That is the most satisfying thing, and to have the tour come in, and my special tour is the Washington Elementary Grade School Tour. It's been coming annually. They come next year to be coming 20 years since our inception, and that tour, we give a presentation to them. It's called a Walking Black History Tour. They come to the center. They go to the Lincoln Colored School, which is still in existence. We had segregated schools up until 1951. They go to the Pine Street Colored Cemetery, and that tour is just the most wonderful tour. That's my favorite thing that I do, is to talk to the fifth graders and get them excited about Black history. And it's always a subject that will always end with someone in Galpolis, Ohio, Gallia County, being a part of that history. We have Christian Scott. His mother, Barbara Scott, was one with Dorothy Casey, who organized the center. And he was the teacher. He still is the teacher. And he started that walking tour. And I'm sure his mother, Barbara, had a lot of influence on him to do that. And it was sixth graders. And then, of course, we now have a middle school. So now it's the fifth graders and not the sixth graders. And they come annually every year. And he's really the catalyst for the walking tour. Other than that, we do Galpolis in Bloom. We do tourism. Anyone can call me at any time. Then my number's on the doors. If you're standing there, if you call me, I'll come and open up and give you a tour. They can just reach me at any time, because I only live about two blocks from the church, so I can get up there in no time to take people through as a tour. The Lincoln Color School, it is still here. It is behind Lifestyle Furniture on the corner of 3rd Street and Olive. But Lifestyle Furniture put a facade around it, just as Moore Hollywood did around the house. But every year he opens that for our tour, and he lets the children go through. The original school is still there. I attended the Galpolis Colored School, the Lincoln Colored School. And I came out in 51 when they desegregated the school. But the school is still there. We had two classes in every room. We had four rooms. We had a big auditorium. We had showers in the basement. Of course, ghost stories to go along with that, so we can scare the children. But he is a wonderful person. That's Mr. Tope. He opens that and lets them walk through the original school. And then we have volunteers, which is a good part. We have volunteers at both the Lincoln Colored School, at the cemetery, at the center, along with me. I usually do most of it, but if I'm not available, somebody's going to do it. But yeah, it's a wonderful tour. But Lincoln Colored School, I have a board on that. I've given that presentation to Marshall University. That's how I got it started. They asked for it, about the segregated schools that was in Galpolis. And of course, they were over in Point Pleasant, West Virginia, but they didn't even know they had segregated schools. They did. And then I just learned that there was another place in Ohio. I think that person was from Portsmouth that told me yesterday their schools were segregated too, Portsmouth, Ohio. So I think it has to do with possibly being directly across the river at that time from Virginia. Because you remember, West Virginia wasn't a state until 1863. And it may have been a Virginia mentality that carried over. And of course, plantation owners were chasing slaves. They'd come across the Ohio River and would chase them in through Ohio. So it may have been a mentality on southern Ohio, southeastern Ohio, that could have segregated schools. But to me, it's utterly fascinating that we were still segregated that long. My dad knew about the desegregation. He was a person who had coffee every morning with the superintendent at that time. So he learned about the fact that they were going to desegregate the schools. And he came home to let me know, because I'm the only one that went. I have three other sisters, but I'm the oldest. And I'm the only one that attended the Lincoln Colored Elementary School. And my sisters all had to go down to Washington Elementary School. But he let me know it was going to be a change. It was going to be a big change. We would be in class with people who probably didn't want us there because of the segregation. And of course, I heard more stories after I was a grown up by the kids, the white kids that was in attendance with me. They came to tell me many of the stories that people said to them on the day, first day of school, when it was desegregated. And they wanted to know, did they go to school with chocolate drops? And they made candy references. And some of the people, of course, we were young kids. We were third graders when I went in. And they didn't know what they were talking about. And one friend of mine said, Bobette, I just looked at her and I said, they don't serve candy at school. It's just the best thing. And he said, I finally got the courage to tell you what happened to me on that first day of school. And he told me that story about them being called candy chocolate drops. I think I was nervous because we actually knew our own friends from the school, just like any place. If you come with a group of kids and they're in your neighborhood, and all the third graders were third graders and all the second graders were second graders, but they were your neighborhood kids. So to go in to meet children that we'd never seen before, and we knew we weren't wanted, there were people we knew that did not send their children to school that day because they did not want them in the school with colored kids. Now, that was the term in those days. You were colored people. And they didn't want them associated with us. And we knew we were not well received for a long time. Some people got a hard time. Boys did fighting, of course. Back in those days, you didn't say too much because the boys did fist fighting. You don't have to worry about getting cut and shot like they do today. You know, everybody stood up with their fist. But yeah, there was some tension in the classrooms. But really and truthfully, all of us that came out of the Lincoln Colored School, we actually were all pretty smart. So we all did well in Washington School. Well, this year in our newspaper, there was they put history quotes in. And I opened up the paper and I read, history is too important to be left to historians. And that struck me because I know that whoever writes the history book, it is their version of history. When I grew up, they told you were slaves. They did not tell us of the inventors and the people who had patents, like Benjamin Banneker, the black people who were the inventors and the patent, the shoes and your street lights. That was never emphasized. You were slaves. So that part of black history I never knew until actually I went to work in the civil rights and in Washington, D.C., I worked in the Civil Rights Office, and that is when I became well acquainted with the history of black people. That's why I love the history now, because actually, it helped to get straightened out in my mind. We were not just slaves. And here in Gallia County, we have such a wealth of history. I did C.R. Patterson. He's from the state of Ohio, but he ended up in Gallipolis in his later years. Nobody knows that. Madison Bell, I'm going to do. He was actually the poet and the writer that wrote with John Brown. And when they hanged John Brown, then he went to Canada to live so they wouldn't catch him. And he's from the Lincoln Colored High School. And that's why, for me, history is really exciting to tell this group of young people that you've got to preserve your history. Go talk to your grandma. Go talk to your grandfather. Get oral history, because actually it's more accurate than written history, because if I take the word not out of a sentence, that's an important word to lose. So I'm the real advocate of, is history actually accurate? And that's why my favorite sentence is, history is too important to be left to historians. That is, history is important, and their history is important. Every community has an important history. Dig around and find it. Find out if in Tennessee, who were your Underground Railroad conductors. There's lists. The history is everywhere. Go to your local history societies. Find out about your community. Talk about it. Make sure it's accurate. Fix it up. If somebody decides that you can't tell that Grandpa's black, you go ahead and tell them that Grandpa's black. Go ahead and get those histories straightened out. Be proud of it. Be proud of our history. You know, we're fussing right now over whether or not to take down the southern parts of the Civil War, all the statues coming down. If you have strong feelings about it, check and find out why. You know, if Grandpa was Robert E. Lee, you want to yell, you want to talk about Robert E. Lee. You might not want to see a statue come down. But if Robert E. Lee held your slaves, go ahead and say so too, because even black people held slaves, and a lot of people don't know that. That up in New York, the slave law didn't come down to 1820. But that was when they desegregated and liberated all their slaves. That's how Isabel Birnbaum became Sojourner Truth. Yeah. Isabel Birnbaum is Sojourner Truth. She was freed in 1820 out of New York. So history is really important, but get into your local history. If you can't be proud of where you live, believe me, you're not going to be proud anyplace else you go.